Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here today. My name's Lauren. I'm an architect and I'm a digital strategist at Callison RTKL. I've recently moved into digital strategy. That's not where I started out. And if I had to characterize my move, I'd have to say that it was more accidental than intentional. And I think there's probably a couple reasons for this upon reflection. One is that this job just simply didn't exist when I went through school. And secondly is that I'm just not a person I would have characterized as being overly passionate about tech. But I think I am curious. And I do just believe in fundamentally trying to do a good job. And I think in our world now that we live in, where computers and machines are able to do more stuff, I think we can use this to help us deliver better outcomes. So today I'm going to offer some ideas about what architects do. And I'm going to do this by reflecting on three stories from Callison RTKL that are experiments in our digital space. And I call them experiments because that's what they are. They're ideas, they're hypotheses, but they're not fully formed, they're not certainties. But I do think they offer a different approach about how to do new things in new ways. I think all architects at their core have to believe that we as humans are inherently shaped by the spaces we live in, that we dwell in, that we work and play in. And Jan Gehl, who's an architect and urbanist, I think says this much more eloquently than what I could say. And he says, first we shape cities, but then they shape us. And Patrick Schumacher, who some of you may be familiar with from Zaha Hadid, he goes on to say that the core competency of architecture is actually around ordering social interactions. So we as architects, when we design and create spaces for people, if we're going to do this well, then we really need to understand people, and we really need to understand how people move through space. So the first story I'm going to tell you guys is an experiment that we did in trying to better understand this movement through space. And our first foray into this is trying to understand movement through virtual space as a vehicle to better understand movements through physical space. This image you see here on the screen is a master planning project that we're doing out of our Dubai office. And in this project, we actually tracked and measured people when they were in the VR experience to see where they were going and what they were looking at. So those colored lines on the screen are where people moved through the project. And then the dots that you see on the buildings are what their target eye movements were. And we're super excited about this. I think this is super cool. And the reason for this is because this, for the first time, gives us as designers really raw feedback about the design. So it's not filtered by someone's opinion. It's not what someone thought about being ugly or bad or whatever. It's actually just knowing where people have gone in the virtual environment. And so if there's an area of the plot that nobody walked to, we can start to interrogate why that is. If there's a building that no one looked at, you can see that tower faintly on the left. Why is that? Is that a very important building? Should we change the design to be able to modify and make things better? And while that's all very exciting, I think what's actually probably cooler is where this can go in the future, because once these projects get built, as we saw earlier today with a lot of these new technologies around sensors and monitoring, we can actually then measure where people do in fact go. And if we can make a correlation between the virtual and the physical space, then that means we're able to test things in virtual with a much greater degree of certainty and then be able to predict the performance of our designs. And not only that, we can then also probably then start to predict future needs, future uses, and help create better places. And all of this is for better understanding, as I mentioned earlier, social interactions around the end user. And this is something where we think data is super interesting, and we know that you guys are all generating a ton of data. We saw with JLL and Equiem, and we saw some really cool examples from Dublin. But we know that there are a lot more people involved in the building process than just the end user. We're all around the table today as stakeholders in this design process. And that's awesome. I think we should continue to do that. But what that means is that everybody's got different opinions, they have different concerns, they're coming to the table with different ideas. And we as architects, our job is to bring this into a singular vision. We need to create a thing, a building, a space that brings all of these concerns together. And so for us, The second story I wanted to tell you guys about was an experiment that we did in how we can use digital and compute to weave that together more seamlessly, get more complexity, and manage that more efficiently. The way that we do this is through something that we call scripts. Scripts are just computer code, but in a visual way, because we're architects and we like pretty pictures. And those code blocks are actually just a set of instructions for a computer to follow. Those are also called an algorithm. So what you see here on the screen on the left are a bunch of numerical sliders that are automatically generating and modifying the geometry on the right. And this is for a project we did for a multi-story residential building in the build-to-rent space. And what we wanted to be able to do was to be able to generate the geometry based on the standard metrics that you see in any sort of build-to-rent project. So things like gross internal area, net internal area, efficiency, unit mix. So by changing those sliders, we can change what geometry is created here. And I think it's important here to note like what the benefits of this are. One is that, to the points made earlier, we can respond to change faster, and we can do that more immediately. The second thing around the role of the architect, I think it's interesting to note what we did and what we didn't do in this process. And so what we didn't do was draw one specific solution. What we did do was create a series of relationships between the geometries and components, so between the small boxes and the larger box, which is the building. And once we've done that and we've related those parts in a mathematical algorithm, we can then unlock all the powers of computational design, and then we can get the computer to generate hundreds of answers. So this graph is all the solutions that were generated using computational design. Each of those dots represents a different solution. So we're able here to generate millions more options much quicker. And usually when I talk about this stuff and I show this slide, someone always calls out, oh, but like, look, that one's really, we would never do that. That doesn't make any sense. So like, what's the point of having all these options? And that is actually exactly the point why we're doing this, because we feel to really innovate, you have to accept something that was previously unacceptable. And when we're doing things manually, we have to be more expedient. We have to be careful with time. So we're only drawing intuitively the things that we think are going to work. But that just means we're never drawing that kooky solution. We're never drawing that weird thing, which might eventually lead us to a breakthrough. So what's really important in this process is that computers have no intuition, and then we could use that to our benefit. So what we're trying to do is increase the number of what ifs per question. So like the number of options per problem. And right now, you know, we've not measured this, but in manual processes, the answer is usually three. There's always three things. But can we have a lot more what ifs per question? Can we, as a company of designers and architects, every time we have a problem to solve, can we offer many, many more solutions? And by doing this, I think we get to a lot more confidence in our decision making, and we can be a lot more convinced of being able to really strive for that breakthrough and innovative solution on any project. So the last and third story I wanted to share was about pushing this even further and looking more into generative design processes. Big word. I know these are all kind of like big tech terms. Generative design is, again, just a computer algorithm, but it's been written by someone a lot smarter than me. It actually is an algorithm that is mimicking nature's approach to evolutionary design. So here, we look to study the design of a shelf bracket. And we wanted to be able to design straight to manufacture. To the points made earlier, we know that this links to something actually very personal for me, because I really believe that we should be using digital to build a more sustainable future. We know that modern methods of construction are a lot more efficient, they save on a lot more materials, and so if we as designers can be able to get better at designing straight to make, then we're really helping in this conversation. So that's one thing about this. The second thing is, again, like the previous example we saw, what we as the designers did and didn't do in this process. So this image on the screen is actually what the designers drew to get to all the options that you saw on the previous page. And similar to the first example, all we were doing was setting the constraints of the design. So you can see there's a wall, there's a shelf, there's some places for screws to go in, and that's all the information we gave to the algorithm. And I think this example most clearly speaks to the changing role of the architect and how we need to be able to operate in the future. And I think we come from a paradigm right now where we're really used to giving answers. And we're given a question by someone else, but you know, in primary school, you're given a question, and then we provide the answer. And in the answer, that's where our work, like that's the work, is getting to the answer. And that process looks something like this. So we spend a little bit of time on the question, but we spent a lot of time on an answer. And I hope what the previous examples and stories have shown you that actually working with computers and machines, this whole process is completely flipped around, where the machine gives us an answer, and the speed of that answer can be just is only limited by the cost of your hardware to generate that solution. But we have to think of the questions. And this is a total departure from how we used to do things. So in the process for the last two examples, we spent all of our time actually framing and defining a question for the computer to come up with the answer for us. And this is a new way of working. And so here I'd like to offer the definition of technology that I find to be the most useful and relevant for me in my day-to-day life and my digital role. And it's from the European Space Agency. And it says that technology is the practical application of knowledge so that something entirely new can be done, or something can be done in a completely new way. And I think that simplifies pretty easily to just doing new things in new ways. And we've seen already today, and we've heard stories about adoption and how that is a challenge. And yes, I know that is a challenge if one person's doing a new thing in a new way. But I think the real challenge is doing new things in new ways all together, collaboratively. And the reason why I say one person doing a new thing in a new way isn't, it's hard, but it's not impossible, is because we ran a little internal hackathon earlier this year, and we asked everybody to design something with a code. So we asked everybody, can you use a computer to make something? And these two examples in the red boxes are submissions that came from our CEO's executive assistant and our director of HR, two people in the company that had never designed a thing in their life, had never written any code, and had never used any design software. So while it's hard to get one person to do a new thing a new way, it's really not impossible. But I think the difficulty comes when we reflect back on the fact that our building projects, and especially big ones, have a lot of stakeholders and then requires everybody in that process to do something new and different. And I think that this is where the challenge is for us now. And I think that ends up getting us in a situation where we're talking about doing something new to the power of new, and that's very difficult. And so I was starting to look at, I've been on this mission lately of like trying to figure out how do we do this, because like we're all really struggling with this. And I came back to a familiar story actually about the Apollo 11 mission. I'm a bit of a space nerd and astronomy enthusiast. But I think we all know that story. The moonshot is a very common tech term, and it's about that like aspirational but risky goal. And you know, that's usually the story we hear about it. But the thing that I found out recently that I thought was really cool was that the moonshot was actually more a feat of management than it was of engineering. And that's because the program employed almost 500,000 people, and it also demanded the collaboration of 20,000 different companies, universities, and government agencies, which is insane. Like, and if we're talking about building cities and spaces, we actually need a lot more collaboration than what Apollo demanded. So I think this is really what represents the challenge we have and the questions we need to start asking ourselves. And I think the last thing I would add about the moonshot is that what Kennedy said of the goal was that it will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. And I think these are the kinds of questions that we need to start asking ourselves. And so what does this mean for us now in the building industry? And so one final quote from another architect is from Cedric Price and what he said in 1979. But he says, technology is the answer, but what was the question? And I think this is really representative of where we are today. And what I would like to just add to this is that not only do I think that this is okay, I think this is actually the mindset that we need to be comfortable in. I think we need to be comfortable in asking questions. And I think we need to shift our mindset from being people that just give answers to people that are better at asking the question in the first place. And I think that we just really need to get better at this. And as one final offering about asking questions, the moonshot, when you hear the astronauts talk about it and like the people who worked on this project talk about it, the one thing they all either say directly or you implied from the way they talk about it, it was just something that really captured their imagination. Like they thought it was cool. They wanted to go to the moon or help send someone to the moon. And I think that we in the building industry need to get better at asking these types of questions that really speak to people's imagination, because I think that's the way we'll get the best out of our people, and I think those are the best ones. So yeah, thank you. All right.